In 1949, a young Australian couple arrived in Britain with a mind-reading act so accomplished, no one could work out how they did it.
They were hugely successful.
Even the magicians couldn't work out what they were using.
Sidney Piddington, for 3 years, had the most famous voice in this country.
Now concentrate on the line while I attempt to transmit it to Leslie.
People would concentrate on something in the studio with Sidney Piddington. Leslie Piddington, somewhere far away, would tell them what it was.
Mind reading wasn't new, but by the end of the Piddingtons' first radio series, 20 million listeners were tuning in, hooked and mystified. Were the couple performing clever mental tricks, or did they really have telepathic powers? This is the story of mind magic, one kind of magic that still begs the question, is it real?
When somebody crawls into your mind and suddenly tells you what you're thinking, it turns your whole world upside down.
Hi, I'm Mark, I'm going to amaze you. I'm going to read your mind. Can I stop you? Have you got 2 minutes? OK, and what I want you to do is to write a three-digit number, OK? But don't show me. Go and get a paperback book, any book you like. You can't actually see, there's no pinholes or anything like that.
I'll just pick anything.
Yeah? None of us can see. I'm going to look away.
Mentalism is basically doing magic tricks with a mental flavour.
Do you have some money on you? Have you got some money? Don't take it out yet.
Yeah.
You've got a, is it a note or
it
is it coins?
Yeah, no, it's
a note. All right, I'm going to put this on.
Okay.
Okay, I'll just pick this one.
I'll just pop a rubber band around that, and what I want you to do, put your hand on top. Can you see the serial numbers? I think they're down the edge, yeah? Just rub your fingers on it and touch my back with your fingers. Touch my back. That's a fiver. What I'm going to do is I'm going to flick through the pages of the book. I want you to say stop at some point.
Okay, stop.
There. Have a look at the first couple of words on the page. First couple of words. Don't say what they are, but just remember the first couple of words, yeah?
All right.
Think about the digits. Think about the digits. It begins with an H, yes?
It does.
And another H.
Yes.
There's an H, H. Think about the first digit. Second digit. Third digit. Think about the first word. Think about the first word.
Okay.
First word. Just excellent. Okay. I'm going to go with that. One. There's a one. Yes?
Yeah, that's right.
And another one?
Yes.
Second word. That's excellent. I've written something down. And it ends with four?
Oh, my God.
Is that right?
How did you do that?
And I think in all of magic, the mental effects are the strongest. They're the most powerful effects.
What's the number you're thinking of?
468.
No!
And I think they affect an audience on a very deep level as well.
Out loud, what are the words you're thinking of?
Send him.
Oh, my God! Oh, my God! How did you do that?
No way. No way.
How did you do that? That's crazy.
That's just freaky. That is, you're weird. Go away!
In today's world, most magic has a problem. Audiences know too much. We may still enjoy magic shows, and yet we're fairly clear that what we're seeing is a trick. So why does mind magic, sometimes known as mentalism, still have the power to truly astonish us?
Well, people are interested in mind magic because it might be real. We all have experiences where we have premonitions, the phone rings, and I sometimes do know who's on the other end of it. So mind magic has this quality that maybe it really is real.
The earliest mind magic routines were called second sight acts and emerged in the late 18th century. This may have been the age of reason, but the superstitious belief in second sight or clairvoyance was common. Mind magic tapped into this.
As an entertainment, the earliest we know would be Giuseppe Pinetti. an Italian performer who did a variety of types of magic in about 1780. And he did this second sight routine with his wife. His partner was blindfolded and seated in the performing area, and he would go to the audience and have them hold up articles. He would say, "What's this?" And his wife would say what it was with amazing accuracy. And people would say, "Well, he must be telling her some way," but they couldn't find a way. At least superficially, this is presumably being done by some telepathic communication. And maybe it is. Who are we to say?
I don't know why it was decided that it was a male-female thing like this, except that they used to sell the idea that the man and woman were in rapport with one another since they'd been married for 30 years or some such thing. I find that the longer you're married, the worse the rapport gets, but that's a different matter altogether. I think that perhaps it started out as a couple act like that, because you have to be together for a long, long time. This is not the kind of thing that you develop in 2 weeks to go onto the vaudeville circuit with. No, it takes many years to develop it.
I think that when people see a second sight act, obviously the first thing they think of is that there's some sort of a verbal code, that when the front person is talking to the medium, he's actually doing a sort of double meaning talk. So he says some convoluted sentence. Instead of saying, "What am I holding?" he says, "Please tell me, if you will, what am I holding now, right now, please, right away?" And some really awkward thing. What makes a good second sight act exciting is that the performers know that the audience has this suspicion, and therefore they don't do that.
But of course we've got another thing here too. We've got timing, and we've got throat clearing, and we've got and various things like that that seem innocuous, but which can provide a great deal of information if they're properly developed.
170 years later, audiences were just as mystified by Leslie and Sidney Piddington's second sight act. This they developed for the radio, a modern medium for transferring thoughts, in a way that would have seemed frighteningly magical to the Panettis audiences.
We always insisted that the show must be live, because even though things were fairly crude in those days from the point of view of broadcasting, you could still fiddle around with things. And we wanted it to be absolutely live so people knew what was going out was happening at that time.
It's on paper. Well, someone's giving a crossword puzzle.
We had people who got us mixed up with old clairvoyants and hypnotists and heaven knows who else. It was amazing some of the things they thought we could do.
Off on a mystery trip from Filton Airfield, Bristol, goes a Stratocruiser.
The Stratocruiser was something that I remember better than anything.
Its passenger of honour, Leslie Piddington, the female half of the husband and wife team who each week baffle 20 million radio listeners. This is to be their most exacting test yet. The object? To transmit a train of thoughts to Mrs. Piddington 20,000 feet up from a studio in Piccadilly. The subject to be transmitted is chosen at random, and Piddington first hears of it from one of the judges.
She is now standing by.
A bird? Saying hello. I can't make sense out of it. Oh, it's two lines. Hello. Oh, I've got it. I can guess it.
And I do remember it. Hail to thee, blind spirit. Bird thou never wert.
I think that's very nice. In fact, whoever thought of it, hail to thee.
But the Piddington stunt that caused the greatest stir of all was their 1949 Tower of London broadcast, when Leslie, secured in the Bloody Tower, correctly quoted a line from a book, apparently transmitted to her by her husband, miles away in Broadcasting House.
The thing that was so effective about the Tower of London was sheer luck. Sid, of course, was in the studio in London. I was in the tower.
At the sound of the gong, I want your complete silence, your sympathy and your cooperation.
But at
the gong, I want your complete silence, your sympathy and your cooperation.
But at that time, there was a huge fog on the Thames, And at the crucial moment, there was a tug that hooted several times.
Something to do... an electrician.
But people thought that was the code.
I think the whole line is... abandoned, as the electricians said, there would not be current.
The idea was that, once again, was it telepathy or wasn't it telepathy? And people had to decide and argue. Of course, we've often been asked to reveal the secrets.
Anything to say?
Well, only thanks very much, everyone, and you're the judge.
And I've always said, no, it's something that will die up with me. People won't know. And I still say, you are the judge.
The Tower of London telepathy test has always haunted American mentalist Max Maven.
The concept of being in there and trying to read someone's mind through all of this surrounding armature and so forth, it just is incredibly compelling.
50 years on, he's at the Tower of London and has devised a mind-reading act especially for this program. Will his thought transference test have the same power to astonish today as the Piddingtons did for their 20 million listeners?
In the Piddingtons' case, when they did the Tower of London, I believe someone thought of a line from a book. Because television is a visual medium, I'm going to try to do something that involves visual imagery, so there's something to show the camera.
From within the very same room in the Bloody Tower, Max will attempt to receive an image from BBC Television Centre, 8 miles away in West London. From there, high up on the studio roof, BBC newsreader Sophie Raworth has been asked to choose and memorise just one of the 100 symbols on this board. Max will attempt to read her mind and identify which one she's chosen. No camera trickery has been used during this experiment. Sophie's been given a monitor and can see a live TV feed of Max at the tower. But Max can only hear Sophie. He can't see what we can.
The monitor that we have on this side for the crew is facing away from me. And in fact, the crew has been instructed that if I try to peek around the side of the monitor, they'll stop me, correct?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Out in the cold and rain is my new friend, Sophie. Are you there?
Yep.
And at some point this afternoon, you decided on a design.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you certainly haven't told me what the design is you're thinking
of. I haven't told anyone, Max. Not a soul. I haven't drawn it. I haven't told anyone. I haven't talked to anyone about it. Nothing.
Nope. Did you draw it somewhere or write it down?
No, I thought about it.
So honestly, no one knows but you at this point?
No one knows. Nobody knows at all.
Well, Sophie, let me ask you a couple of things, because I can't see you, so I have to ask you to hear some things. The designs fall into many different categories, as if the camera is looking at there, you can see it. Some of them are pictures of things, and some of them are sort of abstract shapes. Some are letters of the alphabet and so forth. Do me the favor, Sophie, just say these two words for me. Abstract picture.
Abstract picture.
And now say them in the opposite order, please. Picture abstract.
Picture abstract.
Okay, so now I know we've got a picture. That narrows it down to about half of them have been thrown away, because this is a picture of something and not one of the abstract designs.
I couldn't possibly comment.
Well, I'm fairly certain from that. Now, of course, that I've got, 50 designs to work with now, something like that. Sophie, do me this favor. Say line and curve.
Line and curve.
All right. Say line and angle.
Line, angle.
Do you notice she left out the and that time? That's instructive. So we're dealing with an angle. Say line and curve again.
Line, curve.
All right, I think I've got it narrowed down to about 8 designs. Either that or I'm completely off track.
Wow.
But I think, the designs are categorized, of course. I've eliminated the spiral, for example. Just say vertical, horizontal.
Vertical, horizontal.
Right. Now we're down to about, I'd say, 4 possibilities. If I say angle vertical.
Angle vertical.
I'm going to go for it. I'm going to go for
it. You know from that?
I know. The issue is this. I have a piece of cardboard and a marking pen, and you do as well.
I've got the pen, right. I've got the cardboard. Let me just take the top off it. Okay.
I want you to draw whatever the design is that you're thinking of. I will do a drawing as well, but hold your board so that the camera can't see what you're drawing.
Do you want me to start now?
Start now, yes. Okay. Yes. And, I won't say that this is a particularly artistic rendering,
but... No, it's a good job, Max, because I can't draw, so... I can draw this, just.
All right, let me put the cap back on my pen, because I'm finished. How about you, Sophie?
I'm finished, too.
I'm going to give us a count of three. And on three, we'll both turn our pictures around.
Okay.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
One, two, three. Yes? Is it the same one, really? Okay, wait. Move back
clever.
The camera, because I want to see the monitor. And it is.
Hey,
we've
well
done it. Wow.
Well done.
Well.
How did you do that just from my voice? I'm very impressed.
It's been a pleasure connecting my mind to yours over this long distance. And as to what's actually gone on during this demonstration, all I can say to the people watching at home is you are the judge.
What would you have me do?
Scatter it to the four winds in the middle of the sea.
I think that mentalism has really stood the test of time because it builds on a very basic belief. The notion that somebody might possess some kind of psychic ability. They can read your mind, they can predict the future, and so on.
The word occult, if you trace its etymology, it just means unknown, what's not known. And of course, isn't that something we're all desirous of, to find out what's out there?
And these beliefs have really come up in pretty much every culture throughout the whole of recorded time. There's something that absolutely fascinates us, and mentalism builds and makes use of those beliefs.
If you want to find the roots of mentalism, maybe you have to go back to the Oracle of Delphi. You go back into the ancient world, you go back to the world of smoke and not so much mirrors, but smoke and temples and creaking heavy stone doors.
You would come to consult the oracle with your servants, because consulting an oracle was not something poor people could do. You went down and there was the River Styx and there was the boatman, and you gave them money and you crossed the river and you had the seance.
The Delphi Oracle in ancient Greece worked by herself using smoke that obviously had the same effect as some of the cigarettes that are smoked today that are called marijuana. She didn't go into a trance. She became slightly intoxicated and would ramble on and give advice.
And if you exhibited even the slightest doubt, they murdered you. Because as everyone knew, everyone did not return from the underworld. Some people just didn't come back.
These sinister magical ceremonies were an early form of seance. The oracle acted as a medium through whom dead ancestors could make predictions.
The desire to contact the dead has been a recurring theme of human society.
And in the 1840s, this desire found a more accessible outlet in spiritualism, a huge religious movement that was also to give magicians a rich new source of inspiration.
Well, the first thing I have to remember about the 19th century where spiritualism was born is that it was a very different world. Let's just take one example. No popular entertainment. It was the time of the home party. And originally, the mesmerist started with mesmerism, where they could get tables to move. And you would get together with friends on the weekend and move tables. And that was great fun.
People would sit around a small table, normally a small light table, and wait for it to either turn, if it had casters, or to tip back and forward on its legs.
It got people tuned into the idea of weird powers.
Spiritualism really did kind of burst in on the scene in the middle of the 19th century, in the 1840s. And it started with a pair of sisters in New York State, the Fox sisters.
Margaret and Kate Fox were two little girls when spiritualism started, and they lived in Hydesville, New York. And in their presence, they started hearing noises, rapping sounds.
And they were just little schoolgirls. I mean, they were just naughty little girls. And it was, I think, October. And it was, the winter was coming on, and evenings are very long, and it must have been very boring. And they found that they could crack their toe joints.
And eventually they discovered that they could make a code, as in one rap for yes, two raps for no.
People obviously wanted to know, if they weren't making the noises, who was and who was doing. So they made up a story. They said that it was a man who'd lived in the house before and who'd died. He'd been murdered. You know, here was the dead coming back.
The classic story is that little Kate Fox was sitting in the room and she went... And immediately, and then she went without making a sound. And she said to her mother, "Mother, it can see as well as hear." Now, her mother was a nice Methodist woman, and she was freaked out.
And the word spread. And before anybody knew what was happening, here were these two naughty little girls, had become a sort of cult.
The spiritualists were so determined to believe in the supernatural that 40 years later, when Margaret Fox made a full confession, admitting she had faked everything, some still refused to accept it.
It was the kind of thing that, you know, myths and fairy stories are all built on. And they'd started their own myth. And it was impossible to put a lid on it after that, because people so much wanted to communicate with the dead, because everybody knows somebody that's died. And everybody would like to be able, perhaps, to get in touch with them.
Whether it was real or not, it launched a huge movement of spiritualism.
Because there was no television, one of the most popular form of entertainments was seances. Every town had 20, 30 spiritualists.
You'd be seated around a table. Often people would hold hands or place their fingers on top of the table. There would be a medium present.
The room was then darkened.
And in a situation like that, there's all sorts of room for shenanigans going on.
You had bells. You had stringed instruments. You had strange voices. You had people touching you in different places. There were sort of telescopic rods that were developed for mediums, which had a sort of glove on the end of it or something of this sort, so you could sort of whiz out your rod and tap somebody at the other side of the table. Spiritualist mediums developed a very convenient item called the cabinet, where you retreated in order to have your trance and get your manifestations. Well, it was tremendously useful, because what the cabinet was what it sounds like. It was a curtained-off or cupboarded-off bit of the room where you went inside and you couldn't be seen, and you could wriggle out of your bonds and produce phenomena.
I will now ask the young men to leave the cabinet and draw the curtains while they enter the usual trance.
I am now going into a deep, deep trance. I feel the souls of the departed all about me. Darkness, please.
As the craze for seances swept the Western world, magicians soon worked out the tricks that were being used by spirit mediums, especially the spirit cabinet. They were quick to cash in.
The Davenport brothers were the ones who took it into a showbiz situation. The Davenport brothers were two young Americans who, in the mid-1850s, created what's called the Spirit Cabinet Act.
The Davenport brothers had a wooden cabinet, a bit like a large wardrobe.
Inside which there were implements and also chairs, and the Davenport brothers would sit in the chairs and have their hands tied behind their backs.
Doors were closed, and almost immediately tambourines, which were placed inside the cabinet, would ring, bells would ring,
guitars would play, and things would fly in and out.
Trumpets were endlessly used. because in the dark the voices would come through the trumpet.
And when the doors were opened, the boys were apparently still tied up. So it was said that in the darkness of the cabinet, the spirits could operate freely. Once the light came in, the spirits had to go.
It was kind of a cross between a magic show and spiritualism. The apparatus was spiritualist. The tricks were spiritualist. I mean, it was manifestations like spiritualists did, but in a way it wasn't very religious. It was kind of an in-between.
Now, the Davenport brothers never, as far as I understand, never overtly claimed to be spiritualists. Their manager might have claimed it for them, but their performance was just strictly a performance where they personally made no claims whatever.
In a way, this kind of crossover they had wasn't very satisfactory psychologically for the audience. And so they got exposed in a welter of shame and thrown guitars.
Stage magicians were in no doubt that it was the brothers and not the spirits who were throwing guitars around inside their cabinet. But whilst they denounced the Davenports as fakes, they also pinched their tricks.
Houdini's relationship to the whole spiritualist phenomenon was very, very complex. For a start, at the early part of his career, he himself had done spiritualist and mind-reading acts with his wife Bess. So he knew the tricks and he understood how all this was done.
In fact, it was the Davenports who inspired Houdini's earliest rope escape tricks, which launched his phenomenal success.
In the case of Houdini, he was desperate to believe. He tremendously wanted to believe you could communicate with the dead, because he was completely mother fixated, and after his mother had died, all he wanted was to get back in touch with her. But he was constantly frustrated because the mediums who promised to put him in touch with her were, to the eyes of Houdini, a magician, it was perfectly clear what they were doing. They were doing tricks, and so he was furious beyond measure, because he could see that what they were doing was preying on people and making a mockery of deep desires.
So Houdini incorporated the public humiliation of spirit mediums into his act, exposing them on stage and in the press. Like many magicians, he despised their hypocrisy, but exploiting their methods was also lucrative.
There is a genuine feeling that the methods of the magician are being put to a terrible use here. To cheat people, to deceive them in the bad sense, and to give them false hopes. And on the other hand, spiritualist busting is good business.
Such good business that even early filmmakers could still see the entertainment value in it. This silent film was made 70 years after the Fox sisters had first played their rapping games.
And now to show you how the ghost or ectoplasm was produced.
And later still, Joseph Dunninger, a great American mentalist of the 1930s, was still getting mileage out of exposing spiritualist tricks.
It is a simple matter for the medium in the dark to attach this so-called spirit to the end of his reaching rod and then float it over the heads of his audience.
But by then, spiritualist tricks had become a standard element of the mentalist stage routine.
Thanks to this false hand, the rest speaks for itself.
This was thanks to the brilliant theatrical instincts of a remarkable stage performer, Anna Eva Fey.
People commented upon her gorgeous honey-colored hair that shone in the footlights.
She was an incredible megastar. And people sat and almost worshipped her.
When she teamed up with her husband, they basically created a double act that they called the indescribable phenomenon.
She had begun on stage as a mixture of mentalism and magics. She featured mentalism and magics. She featured a levitation effect and spiritualistic phenomena.
Of course, she created controversy. There were mediums at the time who felt that she was sort of prostituting what they did by bringing it to the stage. She had this wonderful piece which she did with her husband where they had a cabinet on stage and she would have bandages tied round either wrist, tied by a gentleman from the audience, really tight, many, many knots. She would then sit in a high-back chair with a post at the back, and those bandages would be taken and tied and secured to a ring at the back of the post. Her neck would then be tied also with a bandage around the post as well. She was then put in a trance by her husband. He would give her a piece of paper and a pair of scissors, put that on her lap, close the curtain just for a moment, we're talking about split seconds, open it again, and now the paper had been neatly cut into little paper dolls. He would give her a guitar, and when the curtain was drawn, you'd hear the guitar playing. And then suddenly, when he'd draw the curtain back, suddenly the guitar would drop on the ground, the music would stop.
Now, of course, there was never any evidence that those were the instruments that the audience was hearing. Could there have been another person backstage strumming on that banjo and blowing on that trumpet, and then someone inside who might have freed themselves throwing it out the top? Now, we say, wait a minute. Don't tell me that she actually made money doing this. Yes, she was a top-paid artist of her day.
We've got a man with us tonight who's going to recreate the atmosphere of those Victorian parlours where people used to sit with their hands on the tables and things would go bump in the night. Glenn Falkenstein.
And I think if you look now to a modern equivalent, you'll see an act called the Falkensteins. This is Glenn Falkenstein and Francis Willard, who have recreated that act. And it's a wonderful thing to see because you have to appreciate the speed at which these things are done.
Make sure there is no way that she can escape so that the camera in the back can see.
The more you can restrain a medium, the more you can convince the audience that the medium is bound and hypnotized and still, then the more effective the act is.
I want you to sleep. Your eyes are getting heavy. They're getting heavy. I want you to sleep.
So the spirit cabinet really depends on a contrast of movement against the silence.
Let's see if we can make some spirit contact. Spirits, are you there? Watch. The top of the cabinet. That's your head. Gentlemen, walk in that cabinet, please. Just walk right in, very quickly. Walk right in. Make sure that she's still tied, still nailed to the board.
Now, nowadays, we know that maybe it's not the spirits creating these effects. You know, maybe it has something to do with the fact that Francis is in the cabinet. But just watch when he takes a jacket from a gentleman.
Spirits, take the coat. Be quick. You're going to see something you're not going to believe. Gentlemen, would you walk in that cabinet, please? Check the jacket. Go walk right in. Make sure you can't get that jacket off.
And she is now wearing the jacket, bearing in mind that she is still tied up and all the ropes go through the jacket and she's tied in place. Now, she couldn't have escaped and put the jacket on and put it back. She didn't have enough time.
Spirits, take that coat. Be quick. Here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, Francis Willard.
So, how do you explain it? Well, you don't, because it is the indescribable phenomena.
It's one of the most breathtaking moments in magic today, but of course it goes back to Anna Eva Fey almost 125 years ago.
But there was more for magicians to pirate from the spiritualists. Audiences were now used to questioning the spirits at seances.
One of the things that spirit mediums have in common with mentalism, it's communication. It's done with words, even if it's done with messages.
Grandma never comes back and tells you, oh, the will is in the encyclopedia on the second shelf in the library. No, she comes back with messages like, I love you, and I always remember you, and I don't regret passing. Goodbye, and Grandma's gone. But she never comes back with anything interesting or useful.
Early performers such as Anna Eva Fey would also answer questions and do this Q&A act, the question and answer act.
Anna Eva Fey would invite members of the audience to write questions. Questions relating to their lives, about their health, wealth, romance, missing objects, lost persons. There was quite a lot of human interest here. And then, sitting on stage, blindfolded, she would answer these questions. What she was demonstrating, of course, was a double skill. Because, one, how did she know what the questions were in the first place? And then, once she knew the questions, given that so many of them were based personally on the lives of the people in her audience, how could she deduce their answers?
Look directly into my eyes.
Was it perhaps telepathy?
Try to get the name that I am projecting to you now.
A new word for a new generation of mind magicians who had now discovered television. Even the audience at home might magically receive messages across the airwaves. There was no escape.
Please try to feel that I am speaking to you in your own living room. To each of you individually. I'm going to attempt to project a name. It is the name of one of the 33 presidents of the United States.
Joseph Dunninger was amazingly born in 1892. That was the year in which the word telepathy was first coined.
A nice scientific kind of sounding word. So that immediately becomes, again, something that the conjurers and illusionists work into their act. The mentalist act becomes a telepathy act.
Prepare, please. Ready? Concentrate. Begin. Look directly into my eyes. Try to get the name that I am projecting to you now.
He claimed that he never read minds. He did claim to read thoughts, and of course thoughts can take many forms.
The projection is over.
So when Dunninger projected the name of one of the American presidents to millions of viewers at home, how exactly did he control their thoughts? Was there a clue in his introduction?
By all odds, President Eisenhower should bring Dunninger along to the Big Four conference in Geneva to read Mr. Bulganin's mind. Ladies and gentlemen, Dunninger.
By the 1960s, David Burglass, the macho man of mind magic, found the TV studio far too restricting.
David Burglass is a superhero. He's just the man of mystery.
Would you please lead me to the car to start with?
Burglass's speciality was blindfold driving. TV producers and public alike were completely baffled by his apparent extrasensory perception. His approach was to present his incredibly convincing tricks as a challenge to science rather than mere entertainment. This 1966 documentary about him, made for the BBC's Horizon, offered a scientific investigation into his powers.
And I drove down Piccadilly at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, full speed. In those days, we could go round Piccadilly Circus, down the Haymarket, and finally I had to park the car in an underground car park.
Right, gentlemen, that seems to be it. Would you get out, please, and then make sure that you test the blindfold thoroughly.
This challenge to established ways of thinking played perfectly to a 1960s audience. There was a new open-mindedness about the unexplained and the untapped power of the human mind.
People often ask me, do I have any supernatural or psychic powers? And the answer is, yes, I do. Supernatural means better than other people's ability in memorizing, in observation, in suggesting things to someone that they'll then do, but not in the paranormal sense.
I'm sure you are quite used to men stripping in front of you.
One of the things that really, really struck a chord with me personally that David does was his amazing ability to stop his own pulse, and he gets so much entertainment out of it, and it's so impressive.
I will try and indicate to you that I can control my pulses.
David had his pulse taken by a nurse, or one on either side taking both the pulses, and then they move their arm in time, and there'll be an instrument that's hit on every pulse. It's a really surreal moment when suddenly he throws his pulses out of time with each other, and one's beating slower than the other one.
How are you feeling?
I'm not feeling very well.
And you get this wonderful, perplexed expression coming across the medical faces.
Have you ever come across anything like this, medically speaking? Have you?
No.
I would have been very surprised if we had.
and then eventually he actually slows his pulse so much that it stops. And I saw this and I decided, that's fantastic, but I'm going to apply how David thinks, and that just anything is possible. You can create whatever you want if you think long enough and you work on it. And I hopefully have taken it a stage further by stopping somebody else's pulse as opposed to just my own. So hopefully it's a slightly new twist on it. I'm going to bring my hand over and you'll feel it getting slower. It happens already, doesn't it? You can feel it getting slower. And it'll get slower and slower and slower. If I take my hand away, it will kind of stay at that rate for a moment. I've got this little crystal in here. If I use this, you'll actually see that for the moment, that pulse stays at that rate. And this will actually stay kind of in rhythm to it. So you can see that it swings kind of in rhythm there. Now, along with the pulse, you'll actually see the crystal getting slower and slower and slower. Along with the pulse, you can see it, can't you? You can feel it getting slower.
Yeah.
In fact, when that stops, the pulse will be gone. It's gone, isn't it? It's not there. How do you feel?
I felt.
What would you normally say if you couldn't find a pulse?
I'd press the emergency button.
Do you want me to press the emergency button?
Please.
And now it comes back.
Yeah.
And it's back?
Yeah. Oh my God.
There's nothing special about that table. There are no camera tricks either. What you're about to see really happens, with no fakery, no strings attached, and it seems no earthly explanation.
The original idea of making a table move is one of the things that the Victorians did in their days at their seances.
At that time, it had been spirits who were credited with moving the table. By the 1960s, we were crediting the untapped power of the human mind.
I expected to get a crowd of maybe a couple of dozen people midday in Nairobi, but when we started, we got a crowd of over 1,000. But there is a very nice story that goes with it. The next night, I was approached by some Africans who said that they would like me to meet their witch doctors, and they made me what they called an honorary witch doctor.
David Burglass has been performing his table-tipping illusion for more than 40 years. We enticed him out of retirement to prove that even today this telekinetic trick can still baffle.
Now imagine, just imagine, that you can lift this table up with your fingertips. You keep looking at the candle, in through the nose, out through the mouth, and let the table come up with your fingertips. Keep looking at the candles. No, you're doing fantastic, but don't take your eyes off the candles, please. Keep it up higher. Don't let the fingers leave the tablecloth, and you're doing incredibly well. Wow, that is more than I expected, but no, keep it up. Don't worry about anything. Just keep looking at the candles, please. Keep looking at the candles. Will you all stand up? You keep your fingers on the table tip. Don't look away, please. Keep looking at the candles. And now, will you wiggle your fingers to prove that you're not really holding it? Wiggle your fingers and stop. Will you now lift your left hands and keep them up there? Now, lift your right hands. Keep them up there. Look at the candles, please. Look at the candle all the time. And now try and wheel it down by looking at that force in between your hands and the table. Push it down, you can, but don't touch the table, just try and push it down. You can just push it down. You're over there, just let, little further there. It's going down now. Fantastic, you have done. Give yourselves a round of applause.
The 1970s was a time of unprecedented scientific discovery. With a man on the moon, anything seemed possible. So when a young Israeli with a remarkable act exploded onto our TV screens, millions were ready to believe that the very laws of physics had gone into meltdown.
Tonight we meet the man who bent this door key, apparently just by stroking it.
He says he's really psychic. He gets his power from the planet Huba.
It's real magic, from the old sense of the word. It's the core, the essence, the atom of my demonstration. And if someone has a problem with that, take a walk.
Ladies and gentlemen, Uri Geller.
30 years ago, David Dimbleby bent down and he picked up a fork, but I'll pick up a spoon.
Turn it around and hold it like this. Tell me if you feel anything coming from my hand, and also you.
I said to it, bend. I said to it, melt. And I was just ever so gently stroking the thin part of the spoon, because that's easier for me.
It's bending.
It's bending very, very gently.
And I just hope it'll happen here. There are no guarantees, because it's real. And yeah, I'm feeling it now.
It's like it's becoming like plastic.
It's gonna go. It's just very soft now.
It's breaking. It's breaking.
It's broken. There's a crack.
You can if look. It's very.
And it's just there. The minute that fork melted, the BBC's telephone system blew up.
Geller shot to superstardom. He was the right performer at the right time.
There was a starvation, more or less, for a miracle worker. He sort of fell on very fertile ground and took root immediately.
Because it was a very frightening time. There was Vietnam, there was... this was the age of mutual assured destruction, you know, when we all thought we were going to blow up and the world was going to come to an end. People want some kind of outside, non-human agency that they can look to. I think that's something that's stronger than intellect. And so stuff like astrology and psychics fill this very big gap that a lot of people feel.
In times of turmoil, there are always those who claim extraordinary powers and who find followers prepared to believe them. In the 70s, Uri Geller wasn't the only sensation.
James Heidrich first showed up on American television and was snapped up by the media as a miracle worker, and he was making pencils move on tables and making pages turn in a telephone directory and various things like this. It's just a simple thing where he would take the telephone directory and just run his fingers down like this and do this kind of thing, and then he would say, move, and the page would move. Move! That was astonishing. How could he possibly do that? Well, he was simply blowing at it. No big puzzle here.
My whole idea behind this in the first place was to see how dumb America was, how dumb the world is.
Magicians, just by the nature of their performance, are obviously deceiving us. That's their job.
I'm simply not a magician, never have been.
But exactly the same tricks can be used in a very different way, in what's called the big lie, which is that we don't realize we're up against a magician.
Of what use is this to mankind, the fact that someone can bend a fork or a spoon? I don't really see the value in it. Mind you, if it were done by psychic powers, I could see there might be some value in it. In my opinion, at least the way I do it, certainly, it's done by trickery, and I suspect that other people do it by trickery, too. I suspect that very strongly.
If it is some person who has come to see a miracle to be healed, I would be against that. But if that person came to be entertained and enjoy a show, I would leave it as a mystery, as a positive mystery. So I don't think that that is some kind of a damaging lie.
But Europe's blackest hour did throw up one performer who was prepared to cross the line all the way, turning his knowledge into a damaging lie at the service of the Third Reich. Erik van Hanussen began his career as a stage mentalist. But in the ferment of pre-war Nazi Germany, he began to claim genuine clairvoyant powers.
Hanussen.
But in the ferment of pre-war Nazi Germany, he began to claim genuine clairvoyant powers.
Hanussen was the great psychic in Europe during the 1920s going into 1930s.
And he had sittings and he had gatherings in his astrological settings where all these symbols were there and people sat in circles. He usually sat with a light bulb in front of him on his face. and go into a so-called trance and give these fascinating readings.
He was adopted very much by the higher echelons of the Third Reich, and he was allowed to build himself as that, the prophet of the Third Reich. There was one fateful day when he predicted flames surrounding, devouring a building. The following day, the Reichstag burned down. The Nazis began to become suspicious. On whose side might Hanussen really be? And one day the stormtroopers arrived and marched him away, and he was not heard of again.
And he was found, I think, strangled in barbed wire with 8 bullet holes in his head, which proved fatal. Yes, he died as a result of this encounter. And he apparently just played it too far. He went too far out on the gangplank, apparently.
Maybe Hanussen was one of those people who perhaps began to believe in the fact that he had a power himself that he didn't actually possess.
Abracadabra!
Okay, I'm going to try and communicate a playing card to you, so I'm going to make the colour really bright and vivid. Just get a screen in your mind like that. Just start to think about what it is. Get a screen and the little number in the corners and the things down the middle, the bit down the centre of the card, whatever it is. Just visualise it clearly on that screen. Visualise it. Can you see it? Can you see the card? Have you got a card? Was it the Three of Diamonds?
There seems to be, at the moment, a revival of mentalism, that there seems to be more interest in performers who want to try this stuff than ever before.
If it wasn't the Three of Diamonds, you're wrong, and that in no way reflects on my skill. I get asked if my abilities can be scientifically tested. The answer is no, because what I'm doing is not psychic, it's soft science, psychological trickery. I control the conditions, so my testers become my testees.
No one embodies the modern approach to mentalism more than Derren Brown, currently the most well-known face in British magic. But today it's not the trappings of spiritualism or telepathy that intrigue us, it's the mysteries of psychology.
In magic, there is a thing that we generally refer to as a false solution, which of course is not the real solution. It's a kind of way of misdirecting the audience away from the real solution. Now in mentalism, there's always this additional false solution, which is that it's real.
And when you're in position, the first person, please, put your hand above one of mine and say ready when you're done.
Ready.
Okay. Now, I wiggled my right hand on purpose. That should have put you off going there. It made you go over to the left-hand side, so I would say left for the first one. Correct?
Correct.
What do you mean by real? Well, of course, it might mean paranormal.
Next, please.
But it doesn't always mean that. Other frames available are psychological ready. Ones.
Now, you've just seen a left, so I would say you would go for right.
So, people might claim that they're very good at reading body language, that they're using suggestion in ways you didn't think were possible.
Ready.
Okay, you now want to break the alternating pattern that I just mentioned, so you would go for right again, correct?
Yes.
I think what's great is that Derren applies some really genuine techniques. He has genuine skills in body reading and psychology.
He taps into a very basic desire. We all know we pick up signals from one another and communicate, you know, via body language and so on. But here is a man who can really do it, who can walk up to a complete stranger, tell them all about themselves, or go up to somebody and really control somebody else's behaviour. And of course, we would all love to be able to do that, and it taps into that desire.
But he'll also apply some very clever trickery as well. And where that line is, what's a trick, what's real, is very, very neatly blurred.
The stop you're getting off at was
Archway.
Archway, yeah. Excellent. Okay. And you're visiting a friend there?
Yeah, visiting a friend there. Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. You got a good memory?
Yeah, I've got a very good memory, yeah.
You look like you've got a good memory.
Yeah.
What stop, thinking about it now, what stop were you getting off at? Do you remember why you're going there?
To visit friends.
Visit a friend. And where is it? What stop? Is that weird? That must be strange.
Oh, spooky.
Yeah. Do you remember? You can remember your friend.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
None of my friends.
Your creature's house? Where does he live? Look.
Archway.
Archway? I was very... Oh, this is Archway now. You better go. Shit, go. sorry, I missed that one.
There's a great quote, I can't think who said it, that magicians guard an empty safe. Which is terrific, that the secrets that you're guarding, it's not because they're amazing secrets, because there's nothing there, it's just an empty safe, there's nothing in there. So you have to create this whole universe around it. A lot of the explanations, the giving of explanations, for me, is just to sort of let people in a little bit. Sometimes those explanations aren't real. Sometimes it is just to enhance the effect and to lead people down a garden path, which for me is part of the fun of all of it.
The ambiguity, is this real, is this not real, is what causes people to continually tune in. So that if Durham were to start out by saying, this is all a trick, well, who would watch?
My name's Mark, I'm a mind reader. Morning, ladies.
Hello.
Good morning.
Hi.
We're making a TV programme. In essence, it's one performer and one spectator. It's a one-on-one experience, so it's very personal. Think of your favourite food. You're in a supermarket, so think of something in the supermarket, OK? Get it in your mind? It's an airline where you can pick your seat. In these days of reality TV, everybody wants to be a star, and that's what mentalism does. It puts the focus onto the spectator. Poke your tongue out just slightly, just slightly. It gives them that fame. It allows them to be the star for a few moments. So get a seat number in mind. Don't say it, just get it in your mind now. We're off. Okay, I think I know where we're gonna go. Come on, this way. Okay, I'm gonna grab this. Well, my magic is becoming rawer. It's becoming, you know, from the magician's point of view, it's becoming simpler. But the effect on the spectator is far, far more pronounced. Could be wines and spirits, but I don't think it is, no. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Hold on. Oh, yeah. It's much more intense, much more intimate, much more personal. And because of that, the reaction that mind magic can have on a spectator is just mind-blowing. Vegetable curries.
19J. Oh, my God. Shut up.
Is that right?
Yeah. No way.
And that's why I think it's the future of magic.
No matter how clever the tricks, mind magic has had to evolve through the ages to survive. Its basic tricks remain the same, only the presentation alters with the times. So why is it still so compelling?
When we look at the future of magic, it seems to me that it can go in two directions. One, bigger boxes, more explosions, more fire, and more smoke. And on the other hand, the only thing on the planet that can actually compete with all that. And that's the power of the human personality.
The untapped potential of the human mind might just be the last great mystery. It's this gap in our knowledge that allows magic to creep in. Mind magic is the only type of performance where we can still truly wonder, is it real?
I think it offers people the symbolic realization that there are more things than we know in the physical world. And the person who works with the mind is working with something that you can't see and you can't weigh. Now, that's an illusion far beyond the special effects that you see in movies.
And the story of magic continues with The Art of Levitation next Saturday at 8:10 here on BBC Two. Coming up next, a new series exploring the world's most romantic city, Venice.
Politicians used to offer us dreams of a better future. Now they promise to protect us.